High school did you go to?
Miramar High School.
Oh, down in North Florida.
Yep.
Oh, you cool then. And what's your full name?
Robert White.
You know, they call you the White Shadow. You the Globetrotter?
No.
Yeah, man. Because they said you'd be in there. You go. He said you march straight right on in there and tell them what's happening. You know? Right. How did you start this project?
Well, it started with the viral video on Facebook. Shaq ends up seeing the video, gets involved, comes to Gainesville, surprises me and the kids in this pickup game of basketball. Then the whole world saw it. From there, TV interviews all over the world, people wanting to see more, and decided that since they wanted to see more, that I would go ahead and give them more. I decided to start the Basketball Cop Foundation and decided to start promoting connecting cops with kids in a proactive
connecting cops way. With kids. That sounds really apropos. You know, Shaq tried to get me to go to Gainesville, you know, because I'd be juggling, twirling the ball. And he said, this is right up your swim lane. I said, no, I don't think I'll be going to Gainesville anytime, but I've changed my mind.
So you're coming to Gainesville.
I'm coming to Gainesville, and I'm bringing Shake and Bake with me, Frank Streety.
Okay.
Frank is from Harlem. And he tells a very good story about a young man that needs to be better and how you get better, and also about not smoking cigarettes. What is your plans for the future?
Well, to finish out my career as a police officer, I think I have about 8 or 9 years left till I can retire. And hopefully this foundation keeps growing to where I can pick up and do that full time.
You have some very interesting insight on how officers and kids and community should react than I heard in your expression. Could you give us a little bit more of that?
You know, there's so much tension between law enforcement and the community in this country right now, and particularly with the kids,
yeah.
You know, and that's where I'm going to focus. You know, the adults at this point are going to have to work it out. However, they're going to have to work it out with.
Your program, for some reason, has had a really strong effect on the community and on kids. Can you tell me the reason for that?
Well, I think, you know, unless the kids don't trust us for whatever reason, a lot of kids in the community don't trust us. They're scared of us. They see what's on TV. They see what's on social media. And that's all they see. So the only way we're going to change that as police officers is to get out there, get out of our cars, and go interact with them one-on-one. And that's what I've been doing. And by me doing it, it's kind of getting other officers and motivating them to get out there and do the same thing.
So you're teaching the kids and officers at the same time?
Right. A lot of the newer officers, or even officers that have been around a little while that haven't really consciously thought of the issue, and consciously thought of, you know, I'm the only one that's going to fix this issue. Showing them the positive feedback that you get from an officer that's going out and interacting with the youth, they start getting it. And then with the newer officers, for example, this week on a basketball court I built out in Gainesville at a church, I went by there just a few days ago, and there was about 6 or 7 kids out there playing. And I called, I knew my zone partner's a field training officer, and he had a rookie with him, so I called them over. So that this rookie from, you know, right in training can learn the importance of community policing and interacting with the kids. And we played ball with them for a little while.
In Savannah, the Globetrotters have coffee and a cop. And it's merely having people sit down and talk their problems out and see if they can find a solution. And we've been playing three-man basketball with the kids and gangs, more or less, which is almost a different animal.
Right.
What do you see for the future of this program in closing?
I hope it keeps growing and growing. The first initiative of it that I started in donating the basketball hoops around the to police agencies across the country and balls, I think will always be one initiative that will keep going. There's 18,000 police agencies in the United States. I've only delivered to 27. So there's a lot of opportunity that can go forever. And right now I'm actually looking at implementing a mentoring initiative to where we connect cops with kids, not just on calls for service or between calls, mm-hmm. but to where you get an officer who finds a kid in the community that doesn't have a male figure in their life that's kind of adopts them as a, kind of as a kid of their own to do things with off duty and to build relationships with and be that male figure for that kid going forward. That's something I'm working on now, and with funds permitting, hopefully we'll get that going in the next year or so.
So with the retired Globetrotters and the retired NBA players, we pledge to help you, and also you can call on Art Against Vengeance. Thank you very much. The White Chateau.
My name is Lucille O'Neill, and this is Lifestyles TV. I went to high school in Newark, New Jersey, Westside High School, in the Central Ward.
And what is your full name?
My full name is Lucille O'Neill.
You don't have no middle name?
No middle name.
Okay. And where's your family originally from?
My family is originally from Dublin, Georgia.
Okay.
Country.
Okay. Did you have any idea the effect that your son would have, not only in basketball, but in life?
I had no idea that my son would become a household name, because when we become mothers and our children are born, we only want for our children to be upstanding citizens of these United States. But I am proud to say that Shaquille is making a difference in the lives of so many people, and it really is a true blessing.
Do you see clearly his upbringing in the manner in which he acts?
I believe, not believe, but know for sure, that his upbringing has a whole lot to do with his attitude today.
A honest person.
Yes, he is.
I was at your granddaughter's birthday party last year in Carson. And she had a great time, and her friends had a great time, and Shaquille gave $1,000 to the winner of the dance contest.
I know that young person that received that $1,000, very excited. And my grandchildren, they have unusual birthday parties, and they give gifts instead of wanting to receive gifts. And I think that's very special.
Yeah, and all the grandchildren were there, and they were enjoying themselves, and I really like that whole family atmosphere.
Well, did you know that you only saw some of my grandchildren? I actually have 15.
I only saw 7.
Yes, so that's one half of them. They're on the East Coast and the West Coast, so you saw the West Coast grandchildren.
Do you know the effect that you've had on the mothers of the NBA?
I have tried to help the mothers of the players that are entering the league these days, and me and 22 other mothers, we formed an organization in 1996 that is called the Mothers of Professional Basketball Players Incorporated. And what our mission is to simply support the communities where our sons and our daughters live, work, and play. And in it all, we mentor one another. The things that I have learned in the world of basketball, I share all of those things with the mothers of the new players coming in.
It's very powerful, because the mothers last year, it's the year before last when they had the All-Star game in New York. The mothers appeared at a school in Harlem. And when I went to bring the fathers there, they said, it's no use. The mothers already took care of everything. I wanted to know exactly what they did, because these people are very emotional about it. What do you do when you go to a school with kids?
I have to say that I was not in New York at the All-Star game. However, the representatives that were there, I'm pretty sure they only spoke to the mothers and gave them information about their journey in the world of basketball. And what we tried to do, we tried to encourage the mothers that we meet, and we try to let them know that they're not alone, that their lives may change, but we want to encourage the mothers to teach their children to learn what it really, really means to be a student athlete.
Could you tell us this, some of the things very briefly, our time is short, of what you're doing in the community?
I am working in my church, small ministry in Orlando. I'm a pastor now, and I'm a motivational speaker. God has given me a platform. I am an author. I'm sitting on the board of trustees at Bethune-Cookman University. Oh. I'm doing a lot of things. I'm not hurting for anything to do, but I'm so proud of what I'm doing, because I strive to make a difference in the lives of the young people and the senior citizens that I meet on a daily basis.
I just think that's really, truly great. And the effect that Shaquille has when he not only explores but expresses his education is really outstanding. And I've seen the way young people look at him.
One of the most valuable lessons that we learned as a family is that you can never know enough. So I encourage my children to open up their hearts to receive. We're educated every day in life. And education as a whole is very, very important. A high school diploma is not enough these days. So as far as you can go with education, you should.
And LeBron did something very great the other day. He announced that he was going back to graduate.
I'm so happy about that.
Yes.
I'm excited about that. And I wish him all the best.
So listen, last thing I have to say, I didn't know you were that attractive.
Oh, well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And thank you for delivering the keel. Nikhil, don't worry, everything's all right. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
Hi, I'm retired NBA basketball player Jason Collins. I am now an ambassador for NBA Cares, and you are live on Lifestyles.
First of all, I'm very disappointed because you didn't remember me. Most people do.
I'm sorry about that.
What high school did you go to?
So I went to Harvard Westlake High School in Los Angeles, California.
And your name is?
My name is Jason Collins.
You went to Stanford.
I did. I went to Stanford University starting in 1997, and I graduated in 2001. Alongside, I was there with my twin brother, Jaron Collins, who played 10 years in the NBA, and he is now an assistant coach for the Golden State Warriors.
And he dresses very well. That's a fact.
Yes, he definitely dresses very well. We like to look good.
You know, the other day I was at a school, and it was for honors, honoring the great students. And I said, you know, I was looking for some students that are, you know, 3.9, 3.7. So the guy, the counselor, came and said, all these students are 4.0, and we have two 5.0. I said, I've never heard of a 5.0. I've been with Stanford for 3 years. I never heard of a 5.0, but let me touch it.
Yeah, well, with the 5.0, they must have AP classes, so they get their GPA is weighted. That's very impressive, and that takes me back to meeting my freshman roommate at Stanford. I walk in, we start talking, and he casually mentions that he got a perfect score on the SAT.
Wow. Hey, this don't go past that. This is your new roommate, and he tells you he had a perfect score on the SAT.
Yes, and my new roommate, and years later, he ended up getting his PhD from Stanford. Very smart guy.
You wouldn't mind saying his name, would you?
Sure, his name is Jeff Cooper.
Okay. Oh, God. What are you doing now?
So for the past couple years since I retired, I've been working for the NBA. I'm an NBA Cares ambassador, so I work under the social responsibility department of the NBA, and very happy that I get to travel around the world and have many different conversations with all of the partners of the NBA and trying to continue to develop our sport globally?
I am chairman of Art Against Violence, and I travel around doing art show and having conferences with the community about violence in our community. And along with NBA Care, I'm hoping to go next year to Haiti.
Oh, wow, that's great. There's so many common threads around the world, so many stories, so many topics, so many ways that we can unite as human beings, and that's an excellent way to do it. And I hope that NBA Cares supports you, and that there are so many great organizations out there that can support you in your effort to spread that message around the world. We have a tremendous project in that we partner with Lean In, trying to make sure that all of the young men in our league understand the importance and role of supporting the women in our life. And I come from a family of very strong women, so I'm glad to support that project as well.
I think that's truly great. NBA Care is a great organization, along with the wives of the NBA.
We have a lot of great organizations in the NBA. Yes, wives of the NBA. There's mothers of the NBA. They connect all the NBA moms. Yeah, there's so many different parts to it. And but yes, NBA Cares is the main umbrella for our outreach and our partnering with our programs and our players.
Last but least, your brother is now in Tokyo. He looks very good. Is there any future for you in Tokyo?
I don't know. Right now, I really enjoy my job. I really enjoy going around the world and around across our country, having great conversations with all different types of folks and spreading, bringing people together around the sport of basketball. And I'm able to do that with NBA Cares. So maybe down the road, you never know.
So I want to ask you one more question, and this will be a real easy one. It's simply, I'm going to give you my business card. Take a look at it.
Okay.
There you go.
Okay.
Call me.
All right.
Because I care.
All right. Thank you. Take care.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
I'm Tanya Hughes, and I'm from Virginia, and you're watching Lifestyle.
High school did you go to?
I went to Great Mills High School in Lexington Park, Maryland.
In Maryland?
Maryland.
And could you give us the full name?
Tanya Yvette Hughes, H-U-G-H-E-S.
Oh, okay. And you're famous for?
I was on the 1992 Olympic team. Was a high jumper from the University of Arizona, and that year, 92, was the youngest member of the U.S. track and field team. Placed 11th in the finals, and the following year went on to make the world championship team, number 7 in the world that year, and won 4 NCAA championships, and in 1994 was the NCAA Woman of the Year.
I remember that.
Arizona, we had Marise Wayne Jeppe. She was French. I mean, we have a lot of famous people, whether it was Brigida Barrett. She was a silver medalist at the 2012 London Olympics, and she's also a former NCAA record holder. We've had, Bernard Lagarde is another person who, but he's not a woman. So I'm just trying to think of some other sisters.
Last year you got an award. What was the award?
I didn't get an award last year.
I presented last year. I'm on the board. Oh, okay. So I'm a member of the NCAS board of directors. And so last year had a great opportunity to present our speakers. And even tonight, I'll be presenting a few this week. Let's start that over. Oh, you said keep looking at the camera. You guys want to edit all of this, right? Oh, okay. So I'm Tanya Hughes. I'm a board member of the NCAS and really tied to the purpose of the NCAS, which is about using the power of sport to change lives. I've known Richard for over 20 years, and just how you can use sport as a platform to bring attention for issues of social justice. And so right now, whether it's having to do with bringing unity, diversity and inclusion, as well as Right now, we're really focused on human trafficking. It's an initiative that the consortium is very focused on.
Everyone admires your transition from being a great athlete to business. It's a real ball.
Well, part of that is understanding that there will come a point in your career that you're going to have to move from being a professional athlete to a career professional. And one of the things that we need to always keep in mind is preparation. As an athlete, we competed at the highest levels because we had a plan. And it's important for athletes and those who are in sport to have a plan of what they'll do for life after. I went on and got my global MBA from Thunderbird International School of Business. I worked for IBM for 10 years in the technology sector. And I continue to do that in addition to consulting, as well as coaching people as they make the transition from professional athlete or wherever they may be to the next level. So really excited about the planning that it takes to get there, but even more excited to see people develop and grow.
Your advice to a young woman coming out of high school?
Know your purpose. Really pray and seek God about your purpose, because we go to college oftentimes and we can spend a lot of time taking classes that may not mean anything to us. And if I could give any advice, is what are you passionate about? Really try to tap into your passion. Follow that dream, because God has an assignment on your life and there are people waiting for you to walk in your destiny and your purpose, because you are meant to serve them, to help them reach new heights and new levels in their life.
You know, you're more attractive than you were.
Thank you very much. You're funny.
I'd like to thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay.
Have a great day.
My name is Davon Berry. I am from Henry County, Georgia. And lifestyle brought me here.
My name is Jayana Berry. I'm from Henry County, Georgia, and I'm watching Lifestyle.
Devon, what high school did you go to?
I went to Hampton High School.
Okay. And you are going to be going to the next Olympics in Japan, is that correct?
Yes, sir. I will be going to, after I finish college and get my bachelor's degree, I will be auditioning for the Paralympics in Tokyo, Japan.
Why does everyone know that you're going to Japan? Everybody knows.
Because my ambition is to win, and I'm always trying to set myself up for to be great. And that's something that I always wanted to do, is to go to the Paralympics. And the reason why people know is because I'm a multi-sport athlete, and that's what I do with sports.
What made education so important?
Because in order for you to be smart, you have to be educated. So I wanted to be able to imply that ability, and I always say in order to be something, you have to do something. So your education is a key component when trying to be successful.
What is your goal in education?
My goal in education is to ultimately get a master's or doctor's degree in mass communications for broadcast journalism, so I can immediately work for ESPN after I go to the Paralympics and just inspire people with different abilities to be able to know that they are not only are they accepted, but they can be great too.
Your sister's beside you.
Right.
Your sister's beside you. Did she give you a lot of trouble as you were
coming? Sometimes, but most of the time it was encouraging me and not making me feel like I was different, making me feel like I was one of them.
Okay. And who was your hero? One of your heroes?
I would have to say my mom. She inspired me a lot. Also my dad as well. They both implemented Christ in my life, and they both of my parents helped me keep God first.
Let me ask your sister a question. Was he a lot of trouble while he was growing up? Tell the truth.
If the truth is told, he actually, he's staring at me, so I don't know what to say. He actually wasn't that much trouble. He was just really ambitious, and he was just really persistent and ready to go. With that being said, when you have somebody who's defeating the odds, who's basically just cutting against the grain and going against everything that everybody's already put him in a box, it just creates controversy. So I don't think that he was trouble. I just think that he was changed.
And what is your name?
Jayana Berry.
Okay, another Berry. Let me ask you one more question. What is your advice to a young person this day and age when they have so many things pressing against you?
Okay, this is something that I always say. In order for you to be successful, you have to have the confidence. So having confidence is the start of having success. And in order to be something, you have to do something. And you have to be able to tell yourself either you want it or you don't, because success is not given. So I want to leave you with this quote. It is, my ambition is to win, never to give in, with no hope, not to perish, but to prosper, holding my head up high because I know that God does not lie.
I can't wait until the next Olympics in Japan.
Yes, sir.
I think that we'll all see something, and you'll see it first right here on Lifestyle Channel. The winner, gold winner.
Thank you.
In the next Olympics.
Yes, sir.
I'm Yue Tsikonova. I'm about to leave UCF and the UCF Art Gallery to take my next position as a gallery director at St. John's University, Queens, New York.
I'm Jim Whitner. I am Yulia's husband, and I am Yulia's partner in the Tsikonova Whitner Fine Art Gallery, and we will be working together to support art against violence with an exhibit in December in our gallery.
You're watching Lifestyle.
You're watching Lifestyle.
Yulia.
Yes.
What high school did you go to?
I went to standard high school in Russia. I don't even remember what kind of name or number was at high school, but it was. Was pretty unremarkable.
What is your name?
I'm Yulia Tsikonova. I'm originally from Russia, via several countries, and here I am in America, in Orlando, and about to go to New York. Very happy. Well, I am a curator, and I also work with artists, and I organize exhibitions of artists, local and international artists, but majority of them are engaged in some social issues. So this is what really makes me excited. It's arts for social justice, arts for the social change. Oh, that's a gift from my husband, and I believe he bought it at the Museum of Arts and Design in New York, so.
And you're a husband, okay. And what high school did you go to?
I went to two high schools. I went to Long Beach High School, and I went to Lawrence High School. They're about 5 miles apart and about three centuries apart in socioeconomic reality.
And what is your name?
I am Jim Whitner.
And what do you do?
Well, I am partners with my lovely wife, Yulia, in the Tikhonova Whitner Fine Art Gallery in Harlem, which we run in our salon home gallery. And I also am the founder and director of BenefitEvents.com, which is an online auction platform for charitable fundraising.
The whole world is going to want to know, where did you get that hat?
I got it from my neighbor, Georgia, down the block on 120th Street.
Okay. You're going to be working with Art Against Violence, a number of athletes. What are you going to be doing
Well, we will be hosting a benefit exhibition that's going to start on December 11th. That's the coming December 2016. And we're going to be showing artwork by a number of artists, Bobby Hunter being one of them, who are NBA, NBA retired, Globetrotter family. And the artwork, the profits from the artwork, the sales of the artwork, is going to support Art Against Violence initiatives.
A lot of artists are very excited because they're going to be putting their work on your site. What exactly are you going to be doing?
Okay, separately from the exhibit that will be up on as of December 11th, we're going to provide an ongoing marketplace and auction platform that will allow the Art Against Violence artists to exhibit and sell, whether at direct sale or at auction, throughout the year. So whatever venue they're having exhibits in, there will always be a place where people can find that art online on an ongoing basis from any place in this country or any other country.
Do you know who Ray Scott is?
I do not.
He's a former coach of Detroit. He's going to do an artwork.
Fabulous.
Do you know Sam Jones is?
No.
He won 9 rings with the Boston Celtics beside Bill Russell. Do you know who Ferguson Jenkins is?
No.
He's a Cy Young winner that pitched for Chicago and also for St. Louis. And also he played with the Globetrotters.
Okay. I'm down for that.
All of it. Dan Marino is.
Yes.
Yay!
Yay! Well, I'm yes.
He is going to donate some works from his gallery to Art Against Violence and on more website.
Fabulous.
And other artists are going to follow.
Fabulous. Well, it's going to be your website. I'm going to help you run it.
This is going to be really good. This is going to be really good.
Well, I mean,
we're all very excited about working with you and the up and coming show in Harlem on December 11th is really going to be something. And I'm going to have some other artists join me, and we're going to have a great time.
I'm looking forward to it. And Yulia will be there now that she's returning back to New York. So
it's
going to be a family affair.
We have some very exciting news, though.
Yeah.
I understand that your wife will be moving back to New York to watch you. Not watch you, but to help in the overall construction and development of the art gallery.
She's going to be there to make sure I don't mess up.
Okay, I didn't want to put it like that.
Yes, you did.
You're going to be going to St. John's?
Yes, St. John's University as a director of their art gallery. St. John's University as a director of their art gallery. I'm very excited. A lot to be done for the gallery.
Especially because of their tradition in basketball,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So I'm planning an exhibition that would connect art and sports and bring together the St. Johnny's. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. And also along with them, Mel Davis.
Mel Davis.
So we're gonna have a great time on St. John's, and I'm putting together a picture of the great. Jackson.
Oh, wonderful.
Hey, listen, it's been really great. We're going to have a lot of fun here tonight.
Yes, indeed.
We're going to have a lot of fun doing the art show.
Indeed.
Both here in Orlando and New York.
Indeed. Yes. Wonderful.
Dr. Richard Lampson. We have the great Dr. Richard Lampson. You know, I knew your father.
I did too.
a great guy. You know, you have some real shoes that you've been filling. And he was a great guy. Not only the first to bring Sweetwater Clifton, one of my idols, into the NBA. And that was a very brave move. And I have to say brave. How have you been looking at it?
Well, it definitely had a huge influence on me. I was 5 years old at the time, and my first memories looking outside of our bedroom window in Yonkers, New York, seeing his image for swinging from a tree with people under the tree picketing. And for several years after that, picking up the extension phone in our house with racial epithet after racial epithet being hurled at him. As a 5-, 6-, and 7-year-old boy, I didn't know what any of it meant, except that a lot of people didn't like my father, who for me was my best friend, and I would only learn later that it was because he had signed Sweetwater Clifton as the first player on the Knicks.
You served in Africa and other places dealing with racial equality. What drove you toward this?
My dad definitely had a big influence on me. I grew up as friends with then Lou Alcindor and a guy called Leroy Ellis, who were two young African-American lenses for me to view what racism was going on in the country, especially in the New York City area. Coming from an almost all-white city like Yonkers, having Leroy and Kareem as a prism really helped me focus on it. And I knew I wanted to do something on the issue of race and diversity in my lifetime. I didn't know how it would evolve. I didn't know what it would involve sports. But I was lucky enough that things came together, and I ended up founding the Sports Boycott of South Africa back in the 1970s and led the American boycott until the end of apartheid.
What does the Giant Step Awards mean to
you? Well, we started talking about using the power of sport to affect positive social change back in the 70s. And when we started, not many people were talking about that. But the Giant Steps Award winners are people from the world of sport who have had that use of the power of sport to impact their communities. Always moving stories, sometimes stories that the public doesn't know much about. But they're always, everybody leaves here feeling empowered that they can go out and do something themselves to make a difference because of the inspiration of the stories that we tell at these events.
You recently became on the board of Art Against Violence. How do you think this will help affect our community?
Well, I think any way we use sports, entertainment, and the arts, or a combination of them, to reach young people, to reach people in the community, we're going to have a better opportunity to get them to listen. And obviously the subject of violence is something tormenting the community, not only in Orlando where we are now, but literally all over the country.
Some of the people that are going to be awarded tonight here.
I'm going to really have to run.
Okay, could you speak about one of them before you leave?
Okay, so we are, instead of inducting a famous athlete, as we normally do into our Hall of Fame, we're inducting the city of Orlando because of their response to the Pulse shooting. So we have Mayor Dyer and Barbara Poma, who's the owner of the Pulse nightclub, accepting the awards and presenting the awards are Jason Collins, Rick Welts, and Billy Beane, three sports pioneers from the LGBT community. And Lani Ali, the wife of Muhammad Ali, because the rise in anti-Muslim feelings because the shooter was Muslim have spiked in Orlando. So we thought the combination of those four people would have a powerful way to talk about the Pulse shootings and the way particularly that Orlando responded as a united community.
I'd like to thank you for being here. And last is a piece of artwork that was donated. In your name, it's a psychological frame in glass. What do you think about it?
I was very moved at your generosity, first of all, as well as the quality of it and the story that it symbolizes, and we're grateful for that gift. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Richard.
No, it's always-
My name is Johnny Dawkins, and I'm the head men's basketball coach at the University of Central Florida.
What high school did you go to?
I went to Mackin Catholic High School in Washington, D.C.
Oh, and your name is?
Johnny Dawkins.
And what college did you go to?
I went to Duke University.
And did you think that you were going to end up being a coach at Stanford?
You know what? I didn't know what I would end up doing. I was excited to stay in the game of basketball. I had a chance to coach Stanford. And, of course, now I'm at UCF right here in Central Florida.
Did you play overseas?
I did not play overseas.
Huh?
No, I did not play overseas.
Okay. Okay. Do you know that I coached at Stanford?
I did not. I did not know you coached at Stanford.
Yeah, I was there with Dr. Davis and Bruce Pearl.
Okay, great staff. It's a great staff.
Yeah.
I remember it. We talked a lot about you guys when I was the coach there for about 8 years.
I went to a high school the other night, and they had 8 4.0 students there.
Oh, I love that.
And 2 5.0.
Oh, I love that.
I said, I've been at Stanford for 4 years. I never met a 5.0 student. I didn't think they had any.
No, absolutely.
Let me touch one.
No, they do. It's amazing. To see what these student athletes are doing and these students are doing now in the classroom makes us all proud. They're really competing and doing a great job of supporting each other.
One more year and you would have been the point guard at Philadelphia. Why did you switch to coaching?
I wanted to get into coaching because it's something that was in my heart. I wanted to give back to the young people. You know, this game's been great to me. It's kind of a way to pay it forward. You know, I tell our players all the time that you want to be able to leave the game better than the way you found it. You want to be able to help, you know, others, and that's the way you're the most satisfied. So this gives me an opportunity to work with young people to help them grow. Hopefully that they'll take this opportunity when they mature to pass it on to the next generation.
You seem to have been very unique in guard play while you were at Stanford and tutoring and coaching young guards.
I was fortunate. I had some really good young players there that worked really hard. And they became successful basically on and off the court. And I'm looking forward to doing the same thing here at UCF.
Okay. Do you know how hard it was to get a basketball player with a 4.0 or 3.95 or 3.85 into on the team?
Yes, I do. But you know what I found is that that they're out there. There are a lot of, you know, that's what the educational system has grown, and you have a lot of young student athletes really competing to do well in the classroom. So that made my pool, you know, a little bigger than probably people would have thought it would have been. So I'm excited about the young people we had a chance to coach, and we'll have a chance to coach here at Central Florida as well.
Dr. Richard Lapchet, he's a great friend of mine, so was his father. And my godson would be Freddie Crawford Jr. Went here also. It's a great university, and I think you're going to do well here.
Well, I'm excited for the opportunity, that's for sure. I feel grateful that they gave me a chance to come here and try to do something special, you know, to be a part of this great university. And Dr. Hitt's leadership has been amazing. Our athletic director, Danny White, has done an amazing job with all the sports. So we're looking forward to just, you know, taking the program to as high a height as we can.
I have a young man that I've been tutoring and talking to. He's in Senegal. And he is 6'11".
Can I have him? Can he play for us?
I'll introduce you to him this coming season.
Now, that would be great. Well, we're excited. Like I said, we're in a great location. We're at a great institution. And we think it can offer young people a way to change their lives. That's for sure.
I'd like to thank you. And I'd like to thank you what you're doing for basketball and for young people.
Well, I really appreciate it. And I'd like to thank you for this opportunity and this interview.
Hello, my name is Frank Shake and Bake Streety. The organization I want people to donate to is called I'm Not Kidding Around.com. And the number you could be calling me on is 321-527-1177. I'm a former Harlem Globetrotter. My nickname is Shake and Bake. Also, I'm one of the Rucker Park in New York City legend. I mean, big time legend. Also, I'm in the Hall of Fame. I went to two high schools. I went to high school in New York City, in Harlem, Benjamin Franklin. And I went to a high school in Brooklyn, Eastern District.
Now, you know, I didn't know you were at Franklin High School. I did not know that. All the time that I know you, this is the first time I find out. Okay, what junior college did you go to?
I went to Broome Tech Junior College.
And you were a?
First team All-American at Broome Tech. Also, I went into the Hall of Fame of basketball.
Okay, and who were some of the people there as All-Americans that year?
Was Spud Webb, Spencer Haywood, Downtown Freddie Brown, John Johnson, Mike Millen, Ollie Taylor. What other player?
So far, each one of those guys went to the NBA. And
yes.
Had a very great career. And then where'd you go to, where'd you continue your college?
Murray State University in Kentucky. All conference, first team All-American, top scorer in the nation at that time. We knocked off Marquette. And wow. Dean Minniger was playing that time. And also a guy that we was trying to look for again was Eric Cobb. Those are two players that was together at Marquette.
Yeah.
And when they found out that I was playing with Murray State, was a real big thing, a rival.
Well, you went on to play with the Globetrotters. I know this because you were roommates with me one time, and that was a real painful experience.
Yeah, but before that, Bobby, what you didn't know, I also was accepted at Detroit Piston camp. I went there, and I did very well there. And Dave Bing, that's why when I was in Las Vegas, he remember me because I did. I turned it out down there at for Detroit camp
at
that time.
They had Jim, they had Dave Bing, and they had Jimmy Walker. So they were quite loaded at the time.
Yes.
How did you do in the Olympics?
I did very well. I ended up with an alternate with the Olympics. I was I made the team, but had to cut a player for. Ty Kenyon from UNLV was the coach. And they had a lot of guards, and I was the guard that accepted to take the alternate. I was the alternate in the Olympics. But I did all the training, the practices, and playing against everybody during that time before we went to Mexico. And that's how I got a chance to be personally at that time with Spencer Haywood and all of them at that time.
Did you know that you were the fastest dribbler the Globetrotters ever had?
Well, I'm good to know now. Good to know now.
Oh, God. You had a great tour with the Globetrotters and some of the places you went. What are some of the places you went?
Well, I went to a lot of places. I even got a chance to even go internationally. One of the places I really enjoyed when I went to Brazil, I got a chance to meet Pelé. And alive, and I had an opportunity during that time to go to his hometown, and that was in Santos, and I was very scared. It's a bridge you have to go over to get to Santos, and it was a human-made bridge they made, and it was very high, and it was very scary. I got a chance to deal with him, and ironically, he came back to New York City as the Cosmos, soccer. That's the first time we had a New York team in soccer, professional team, and he was one of the person who was running it, Pelé. I had an opportunity also to go with Argentina, over there at the club called Boca Junior, and that's where Ginobili was all over there at that club in Argentina. And Corrientos Street was the hardest street to cross. It was like crossing eight avenues. When I got the chance to play in Argentina, I did all Mexico, Puerto Rico, Chile, all the whole school. I also got an opportunity to play in we had to have drop nets. It was in the Mongols, in Africa called Mongols, back, and I had a chance to go there also and play. Also in a small town that a lot of people didn't even know was called Suriname. They didn't have cars. You saw a car, which was amazing. And most everybody at that time rode bikes. And if you saw some of the Olympics, you see the town is made up maybe about no more than about 5,000 residents at that time in Suriname.
Who are some of the players you played with in the Rucker? Because you had a very great career in Rucker Park in Harlem.
Well, I played with, well, we represent Harlem. And the name of our team is called Millbanks. And there's a lot of players from all over, like Brooklyn, USA, Long Island with Dr. J and all that stuff. You know, Bronx, USA, you know, they had. But in Harlem, exactly in Harlem, my teammates was one of the guys you kind of know about is helicopter. You had to go up and he'd get a rebound. He'd come down so slow, go up so slow. That's why his nickname was Helicopter. I went on from there to play with Joe Hammett. He was a top player, the GOAT, P.B. Kirkland. P.B. Kirkland and myself, which everybody know in Rucker, that I was like a legend in Rucker Park, could represent Harlem. And every time we play, people from all over used to come see us. They'd be on the fence, in the trees, in the raffles, everywhere.
My name is Drew Gooden, NBA player for 14 years, recently retired.
And this is going to be shown in Europe and India. What high school did you go to?
I went to El Cerrito High School in California. Well, we're now to have Google out. So you can go online right now and just type in El Cerrito High School. You'll know what I'm talking about.
And your name is?
Drew Gooden.
No nickname?
Drew is my nickname. My real name is Andrew. But I've been in the NBA for the last 15 years, recently retired. And that's me. But Drew. Drew is my nickname. I wouldn't say it was rough retiring. I had my, yeah,
last year.
Absolutely.
So, yeah.
You know, I think I milked the cow dry, put it that way.
Well, everywhere you went.
Uh-huh.
And everywhere you went, you started to even do better there. What do you contribute that to?
We get better with age. And I also have to give myself credit with my dedication to my work ethic. I think that really helped me to allow to sustain a career as long as I've had. And I think the more guys put into their body and their mental health, they can prolong their careers, and I was one of the factors of doing that.
So that's what you would be saying to young kids at a basketball clinic.
And I'm saying this to the whole world right now. Not just the basketball clinic. It's the whole world.
What inspired you? Because a lot of young kids and players would want to know.
I think what inspired me was, what was really driving me was my struggle as a young kid trying to get out my situation of poverty. Growing up in Oakland, California wasn't one of the easiest things to do as a child. And I think that's where I got my drive from. And I continued to succeed not only in basketball, but in the classroom as well. I knew that was important, education. So you mix those two together, you got a hell of an antidote.
Okay, but how did you that classroom?
Well, I had a father who was it was a big part of my life. And not only did I have a father, I had good people around me. I had good supporting cast of friends. And he always said one thing, my father. He said, you know, you show me your friends, I'll show you your future.
Now, you played all three positions, small forward, big forward, and center.
Yeah.
Now, how did that come about?
I had to find a way. You know, I didn't want to go back to Oakland. So, you know, I was a man of many hats throughout my career. You know, I've played multiple positions and I sustained a long career. So, I guess I had to tip my hat to myself on that one.
And you got along well with your teammates. That was something we always saw.
That's huge. I think that's one thing that you have to lean, you know, be dependent on throughout the season is your teammates. Because collectively, you guys are for one thing and one goal, and that's the win. And you need your teammates. You need good camaraderie. You need good people in the locker room. And I was one of those guys.
What do you do now?
Well, right now, I recently took a position with the NBA, so I jumped off the hardwood into the suites. So I'm behind the scenes now. I'm on the business side. So so far, so good. It's going well, and I'm enjoying this transition.
Well, listen, man, it's exciting to meet you. I've always been a fan. And tell everybody where you're going now.
Well, right now, I'm going to opening night, the Orlando Magic versus the Miami Heat, the 7:30 tip off tonight. And I gotta be there.
Okay. Drew Alexander.
Thanks for having me.
Okay.
As the crowd settles down behind me, tonight's events are over. A marvelous event. As the t-shirts show where they praise Orlando for being not bitter, but for uniting together after such a horrible incident which almost tore a city, less a state, apart. The crowd that's in the background all came here as a part of the rallying point. Dr. Lapchek was truly great. And the mayor was really great. He was really right on target. He put this whole thing into one phrase. We will survive and we will stay together. And we have a t-shirt to tell the world who we are. And the t-shirt simply says, we are Orlando. Hey, that sounds great. Tonight, we came to celebrate with Bob White. Bobby White. We call him the White Shadow. He's getting law enforcement and young youth of America to bond together. I can think of no greater tribute for an officer of the law of the United States to take the time out to stand up against violence in our community, as we all sooner or later have to stand and take a stand against violence. I'm happy that Lifestyle Channel took the time out to stand up for violence in our world, less our community. My organization, Art Against Violence, which we have a portrait of Dr. Richard Lapchek here, which will be auctioned off, and the money from this auction will go to a local recreational facility so that we can help youth in their studies, in their life. Empowerment through recreation. And all it means is recreating our youth. I'd like to thank you, and I'd like to thank Lifestyle Channel for being a part of this world.